Hey, I'm E23. You're dialed into Electronic Air on KGNU Boulder, Denver, and Fort Collins. Tonight's special edition of Electronic Air, I've been featuring an exclusive interview with engineer, composer, and producer Danny Hyde. Danny has been a longtime collaborator with Peter Christopherson and Jeff Rushton, a.k.a. Jhon Balance, from the band Coil. And he is also renowned for some of his early engineering and recording work for electronic artists, the likes of Adamski, the KLF, Frankie Bones, Lenny D, Dave Ball, and Psychic TV, all from the acid house era and the early rave days. I caught up with Danny Hyde in the spring of 2008 in London, and we shared several hours of discussion, which have been parsed down into tonight's exclusive special interview for this edition of Electronic Air. We're going to go into the second hour of that, but before we do, I'll walk us through the track list of what's been played so far. There's been a lot of material covered that has been discussed throughout the interview material with Danny Hyde. We kicked it off at the top of the hour with a classic from Flowmasters, as mentioned, Frankie Bones, one of the key producers behind that act. That was a track called House the Crowd, the Dub the Crowd remix of that, off of the classic rave era EP called Energy Dawn. Went into some other music from some of Danny's earliest associations with Coil. From the unreleased Hellraiser themes, we heard the Box theme, and then went into a classic from the album Horse Rotivator called The First 5 Minutes After Death. Also, material in there from what is probably Coil's most widely recognized album, Love's Secret Domain, yes, LSD. Disco Hospital, we followed it up with the acid house era classic The Snow, the original mix of that, and then the hyper freakadelic Astral Paddington remix of Window Pane. Also from that album, we heard Further Back and Faster with the infamous Charles Lawton quote of the fingers of the left hand say love, fingers of the right hate. And then also from Love's Secret Domain, another classic, something that is much more on the melodic and sort of ambient tip called Dark River. We finished it off with a lengthy track from Coil that is actually an exclusive written by Danny Hyde, but credited to Coil. It first appeared on a Sub Rosa EP called Chaos and Expansion. The track is called Baby Food. And it was later compiled on one of the Unnatural History series released by Coil, compiling a lot of their rare and B-side tracks. That was on the Unnatural History 3 release. Going into the second hour, we're going to hear more material from Danny Hyde's association with Coil, including some of the tracks that he exclusively authored as well, including Protection and NASA Arab. And then we're going to go into some of the more recent material that Danny Hyde has been able to put forward in the last few years, including the long-awaited mastered official release of Backwards, which was recorded at Trent Reznor's Nothing Records Studio in New Orleans. It was really a project that kicked off in 1993 and continued through 1996. The album became lost for a couple of decades, circulating only in bootleg form, and then also having some reworked tracks appearing on two other albums in the Coil catalog, the first called The New Backwards and the second called The Ape of Naples. Backwards, as released by Cold Spring Records, actually compiles, masters, and issues the original album as it was intended to be released back in the mid-90s, thanks to Danny Hyde's hard work and input on that. Similarly, he has recently issued another Cold Spring release, credited to Coil and Nine Inch Nails, called Recoiled. This is outtakes from the Coil remix sessions of Nine Inch Nails that appeared as the EP Further Down the Spiral. that album now called Recoiled. We'll hear some more material from that coming up, as well as a lot of other more dance-oriented material in the next 53 minutes or so. I'm E23. Thanks for joining me for tonight's special edition of Electronic Air, featuring an exclusive interview with Danny Hyde. I don't know.
Well, let's talk then about NASA Arab and First Arc Ride, and, you know, in particular, because that was one of those first 12 inches to come out that was, you know, Coil versus the Eschaton, which is like this almost new identity.
It's funny because I'm going to sound really bad now, but those three tunes I wrote. I mean, they're the only three tunes I could say I wrote and delivered. Everything else, they probably started, and if I've got credit on it, it was, you know, their tune. But NASA Arab was an experiment. They were having dinner downstairs, and I got my MPC 60, and I thought, wouldn't it be laugh to do like a, what did I do, 13/8 beat or something? It was like a 6/8, 7/8 beat. One bar of 6/8, one bar of 7/8. And so the loop turns around, you don't know where it's going to come. So you start with your little conga bit, and it comes, and you think, oh, and you try and play bass to it, but it comes back at you before you're ready for it. So it makes an unusual thing. So I'm having an experiment like I always did. Whenever they went off to do something, I'd mess around with equipment. I got a little desk. We were in their studio in Chiswick, which was essentially, we'd hire in stuff at that particular time. They didn't have a set studio. And I'd mess with things. I was always messing with things. And that was an experiment. I thought I'd mess with time signature and see what happened. And the guys come back from dinner and they liked it. So I started it. But the key bit of that, the bit I love most, Pete delivered, which was the nose flutes. Mongolian nose flute. So yeah, so say I had written it, I didn't deliver that one complete. I had the groove going and this drum's feeling, and Pete's got his record out, started playing those nose flutes, and it's like, yeah, that's great, let's chuck that on there. And that's how that developed. But that was in their house. That never made it to a big studio or anything. It was just written and made in Chiswick. Thank you.
let's move on to backwards. We touched on it a little bit. Now, it's interesting that there were really the two permutations of it released before the official release of the album. So, you know, we had the new backwards, we had everything that ended up on the Ape of Naples, and you know, and really those are posthumous after Jeff's passing as well, right? So can you talk a little bit about how Peter engaged you to come back and help complete those, and then what happened really with the completion of backwards after both of them were gone?
Well, when we made backwards, like all the Coil things, it's been something that had been bubbling for three years in the case of backwards. 93 we started it. And when we went out to Trent's studio to mix it, we wrote new bits out there, like Cold Cell, Fire the Green Dragon, or whatever. I think at the time we were very happy with it, you know. At the time, we came back from New Orleans really, really happy with it. And because I had now secured my royalties on it, of course, I was very eager for it to be released. And I waited, and I waited. And sometimes you wait a year while they get a cover together and things, and they change the names of the songs, which always makes it hard for the registrations of the song, because you have to read. But I waited. And then I spoke to Pete. I said, what's going on with backwards? You know, why is it not released? And they said, well, there's problems with the contract, in that Trent had allowed us to use the studio for free. Trent's not to blame here in any way, I don't think. But the bigger label, Interscope, they wanted Pete to sign some contract, maybe tying backwards to them. But from Pete, it seemed they wanted to tie his video work as well. But it was a handcuffs type contract, and Jeff and Pete were not signing it. And it was going backwards and forwards, and over time, and say, how's it going? We haven't sorted that out. And that became sort of mantra, if you like. It hasn't been sorted out. And that drove me away from the music business, because I'd finally secured royalties. And it was a principle. I'd finally secured some royalties on something. And now, because of machinations, which were nothing to do with me, it was not going to come out. And I was so disgusted by the whole process, I quit. I phone call up. I said, I can't do this anymore. I just can't do this. You know, this dance. I mean, going back a couple of years on Nasser Arab and First Dark Ride, we drew a bunch of royalties, and then suddenly World Serpent had gone under. So they kept the royalties, you know. And so finally with the backwards, we've not released after we've done all this work, and we produced what we said was a great album at the time. For some grey men in the States to be causing a problem and not have it released, I said, I can't do this anymore. I cannot do this anymore. And so in 1998, I sort of quit the music business, if you like. I went to work for ITN, TV Sound. And then in 2002, I got the urges back. I was getting so bored. And so I phoned Pete up, I said, oh, I know I walked away 4 years ago. I know I walked away. But I want to get back in. You know, what are we doing? And he said, well, we live down in Western Sioux, mate. Come down. So I popped down there and we did Unearthly Red, and we did Remote Viewer. And, you know, we did some, and it was fun to be part of that thing. To be amongst the guys. Now, obviously, there was new guys around. There was the Psycho guy, Simon, was around. Fipal Sandra, I didn't see. He tended to be, I think, more for the live gear. He wasn't at Western Sydney at the time. But suddenly it felt like, after working for all those years, from 85 to 98 almost, to suddenly walk back in 2002, it was almost like when you see really good friends that you haven't seen for a while, you don't need to fill in the gaps. You just kind of fit the state in the spot. And I arrived with the MPC 60 and me Akai and the various bits of equipment, keyboards and that. And Pete had a new setup on his computer at Ableton Live, and we just sort of jacked the systems together, and we were off and flying, and it was fun. It was really good fun. This happened for a couple of years, and then suddenly Jeff died, you know. Jeff died falling down in Western Sydney, falling down the stairs. So obviously backwards was, you know, it was out the door, it's gone, no more thoughts of backwards, you know. And I left Pete to get onto whatever he was doing, selling up a place in Western Sydney and moving to Thailand. And then it so happened that my divorce came in, and my good friend Pete, I contacted Pete in Thailand. I said, look, I'm losing where I live. My studio, which I built, taking a year to build in an outbuilding. I said, I'm going to lose access to that. I'm sleeping on people's floors. You got any work? He said, well, actually, I do. Come out to Thailand and we'll get on with something. So I went out there and he had the streams from New Orleans. And he was in the, you know, in his mind, he thought, let's update backwards. Jeff's gone, but we've got his vocals. Years had moved on. Styles had changed. Coil had gone into the droney stuff. Backwards, as we'd done in New Orleans, wasn't relevant to what Pete wanted to do then. Plus, being a creator, is you can't just, you know, 6 years after the event, or whatever it was then, when it was 10 years after the event, release the thing as it was. You want to change it. You always want to change things. It's just the way it is. So we found ourselves working on tracks that became the new backwards, which a lot of them were the original, you know, streams from New Orleans. And then he put that out. Now, Ape was in the gap. Ape and Naples was in the gap just after Jeff died, I think. And that was a compilation by Pete. I didn't have any involvement in that. He used what? Bits from New Orleans, and he updated some little things, and he released it as a sort of posthumous release, a hybrid, if you like. New backwards was maybe because he had new software. He loved his software, Pete, and maybe new backwards was his version of how he then saw those tracks. It was a proper release for him. Now the backwards release, which now Pete and Jeff have gone, was strictly speaking not an official release, but it was my way of saying I'm going to get my bloody royalties. It's the last thing I do. No, it was that. I've got to be honest. It was financial. It was financial. No lie there. But also, when we made the album, there's certain things on there like the text. I think stand the test of time, but they do. And I thought, well, if you're going to have a core collection from Window, from Horse Road Evader, Love Secret Domain, to the new backwards, to you know, the ones that Thigh Paul Sandra did, the music to play in the dark ones, if you're going to have that, if you want the proper timeline, you have to have backwards as it stood in New Orleans. You have to have that, because that's part of that timeline. So I didn't mind doing a deal and getting released, you know. It was a lot of whack, obviously, but you know, it was done for the purest of motives, money. No, it was done because I was proud of some of the stuff we did there. Cold Cell, I mean, I know it came out in different versions, but I liked the chords I played on it. I played all the chords on it, and I liked it. And I thought, why shouldn't it get a proper release? If I don't release it, it'll be on some bootleg somewhere at some point. Why don't we do it? We'll do it properly. And I knew. Maybe Jeff would have had a go, but I know Pete would have understood.
Ah!
It was our natural progression. And if anybody's got the full set and they want to see the journey, that is a part of the journey. You can't just erase the part of the journey because the lawyers in America caused the problem. That was part of the journey. It wouldn't have been called backwards, I'm sure. It would have, you know, Jeff keep coming up with new names, but that was going to be released.
Yeah.
As it was, as we released it. So I didn't feel bad at all doing it. But we took some flak for it. We took some flak, obviously.
Yeah.
It's cool aficionados, but Coil fans were always in different camps. What they never seemed to realise was this guy saying Coil's horse rotovator, and this guy's saying, no, it isn't, Coil's, you know, astral, whatever. And no, the Coil guys liked shifting. They didn't want to be there or just there. Like I say, Jeff would say, no, that's old Coil. Let's not do that. You know, they wanted to shift around.
Okay, Nine Inch Nails. You know, obviously we've gotten into the backwards stuff. Let's talk a little bit about some of those remixes, particularly some of the things that recently resurfaced as Recoiled.
Right, well, that's a different story in itself. But the original, Pete gave me a call and said, look, we're going to do this Nine Inch Nails remix. And I said, well, who the hell are they? And he said, well, come over to the house. And he played me, I think it was Hole in the Head or something, a video, and he explained who this guy was, and I said, well, it sounds quite good, yeah, let's go and see what they got. So we went in and we got the multi tracks and we did what we could. I won't go into the boring detail of how we did a mix, we sent it over there, it was accepted, Trent seemed to like it, it got used on Young Americans the movie, and so then, you know, a couple of years later they sent us some Closer. We did the same thing, and he seemed to like it. So then we did the Downward Spiral and Erasure. But each of those has a really long story, which I don't want to bore you with, within them, because they're all totally different.
Well, why don't we touch on a couple that you think are the most interesting?
Okay, well, Closer, I'd say, because that's the middle ground. That's probably because that got used on Seven. Now, Closer was strange. We decided we didn't want to spend all our money in a big studio. So what we did is we hired a big studio to go in for one day. And we transferred, it was 48-track multi-track, the original recording. So we transferred every track from the multi-track. So let's say, snare drum, track left, track right, synth code from the multi-track. Because there's synth code on the two multi-tracks, keeping them synced together. And then we took, you know, we spent a day doing this. Only a day studio time. And we both made copies of these days. Pete bowled off to his house, I bowled off to my house. And the understanding was, work to the synth code that's on the DAC, first off. This is the signature, this is the key, do what you want. So Pete went and did what he wanted, I did what I wanted, and we knew that when we met, we were in the same time signature, the same key, basically the same material. So we should be able to meld it together somehow. With the multi-tracks, which have, you know, the key, lead vocals and everything, we should be able to, it should all seamlessly be able to mesh together. And when we came together, before we went to the big studio, we synced up on machines, and I played what I'd got, and he played what he'd got. We said, oh, we'd like a bit of that, and he said, oh, I like that bit. And we kind of created a new sequence from these bits that we had. And then we went in with the machines into the big studio to mix it properly, ran the two multi-tracks with the original material and ran our new thing against it. And anything from the multi-tracks that didn't fit in with our thing, we just muted the button, so to speak. And created a third hybrid, if you like, or maybe even a fourth hybrid, who knows. And it was really, you know, it was enjoyable because we saved a bunch of money on the studio, but more importantly, we got more time in our relaxing home studios to play around with the things. I'd never heard of anybody else working like that. I'm sure now, well, now the big studios tend to have gone, so it might not happen, but at the time it was quite unique to work that way, to work nice and uncomplicated at home with a fair understanding that when you said you're ready, you'll book the big studio to finish. It was almost like writing as opposed to remixing. Years later, let's jump right now to 2012. I get an email from a guy, I think it was in Greece. He said, look, is it true that with the Nine Inch Nails remixes that you did a lot of work at your home studios? And I said, yes, that's correct. And he said, are there any outtakes? And I said, well, I'll have a look. So I dug out my dad's, and we didn't have the mass storage we have now. You couldn't store every single tape. We were going for that. We tended to just do snippets of bits and bobs, just so that when you got to the big studio, you could use it as a reference point to what you were doing at your house, match the reference, get going in the big studio. But I listened to it, and I thought, you know what? I was such a control freak. I wrote down every single note of how to recreate what I was doing at home. So what I'm going to do, and it tied in nicely with giving up alcohol. I had too much energy. So all of a sudden, I had so much energy at home. I thought, what I'm going to do is I'm going to do an experiment. I'm going to get out the floppy disk. I'm going to get out the notes. I'm going to call back files. And I'm going to see if I can match it to the snippet I've got on the DAT there. I did. And I thought, well, I tell you what, I'm going to run the whole sequences then and just remix them. Remix them now. Straight to DAT. I'll mix them straight to hard drive. And I did it for one song. I thought that was fun. It was real fun. Okay, why don't we do Closer then? All right, we'll do Closer. And then I did Closer. And then I thought, well, you know what? Let's finish the whole one. So I did Spiral and I did Erasure. And I contacted the guy in Greece and I said, well, look, I've got these for your forum. I've got these for your Nine Inch Nails forum. I've got these bits. And I thought to myself, I'm not going to tell him I've just done these, because he's asking for archives. And I know, I'm not stupid, but I know there's a certain kudos in him believing that these come from Coil. But I know, because I was there in the originals, I know how we made these. And I'm making them the same way, because I was there in the beginning. So I delivered them, and they really liked them. And I thought it's great, because if I hadn't sat that week up in 2012, they would have had a 30-second blip here, a 20-second blip there that went to digital, DAT degradation. You couldn't hear it. And I could have sent them a load of paperwork of the notes of how they might create it if they had exactly the same synthesizers, files, samples, everything else, you know, etc., etc. And I left it at that. It was great. They got it, and they put it on Pirate Bay or wherever they put it, and they said thank you, and it was great. And then a year later, Cold Spring got in touch with me and said, can we release those? You know. And I thought, well, I'm still not going to tell Cold Spring that I actually mixed these in 2012. Because I didn't have the time to tell them the whole backstory. That these were genuine from 1994. They were genuine, but they just so happened to be reproduced in 2012. So I thought it's too complicated. I'll just let them believe that these are original Coil archives that we did. Because the funny thing is, aside, this has nothing to do with Coil, but to do with remixes. Jeff didn't like remixes. Jeff was so uninvolved in those remixes. But everybody liked to believe that he was there, when it was essentially, well, the last two were with Drew, and Jeff was there for the last two. But essentially it was Pete and me, just getting on with the job because it needed to be done. Our job needs to be done, let's get on with it. I don't remember Jeff at Closer at all, but he was certainly a gave up, because I gave him a job to do this fiddling with these control things, which did that nice job he was there in front. But I thought, no, the reality of these remixes are, it was me and Pete, we kept really meticulous files, and all I need to do is reload the files, and with a bit of jigging and playing, I can match what we had back then, in the small studio, not the released versions that went out on record, but I can match what they're asking for. And I did, and anyway, so Cold Spring came and said, look, but he released them as Recoiled. And again, you know, they got some good reception. I mean, in the Quietus magazine, they were voted Remix Album of the Year 2014. Again, the writer of the review was given a more credit because he was attaching the fact that they could be lost archives. It made them more magical. If he knew the truth of the story, that a bloke who was trying to give up alcohol was spending his nights in 2012 recreating his life. No romance, But I was pleased it went to number one. It just made me laugh inside a little bit, because I thought, I'm playing a bit of a puppet trick here, and at some point I'm going to have to come clean, mainly because I quite like the credit for doing this stuff, because it's not that easy to reproduce something from all those years before when everything has changed. But I don't want to kill the romance of it, so I let it go a couple of years before I get the true story out there. But I'm pleased to say the Nine Inch Nails, which is essentially what it's called, it wasn't for Coil fans, I weren't drinking Coil fans, but these are from Pete and Jeff, that was not the idea. It's just, these are archives from the home studio before the big studio mixes. And the Nine Inch Nails guys, some of them might like Coil, I don't know, but they like these tracks, so that was my main goal, and I was happy that I achieved it.
Help me get away from myself. Help me.
About how you learned about Peter's death. You actually started our conversation with it, but we didn't catch it.
I've been telling Pete, I'd moved in after the homeless hostel. I moved into this place. I got offered this place in Surrey, a council place, because my four kids were in Surrey, so they offered me this little place. And I'd started growing things. And I told Pete I was going to grow these vegetables. And I got this long email about stuff, you know, and he was talking about how important it was to grow things and the regrowth of life and all this. And I thought, this is strange. I thought people would just say, well, good luck with the carrots, my friend. I read this email and it was really quite touching. There was other stuff in there which I won't mention, but it was really a touching email. It was almost like a veneer had come off a bit, and he was talking straight to my soul. And then I got a Skype call from a guy called John Deke in Texas, this guy that, you know, we released electric sewage. And he said, hey, you heard about Pete? And I said, hey, what are you talking about? He said, Pete's dead. I said, you're an idiot. What are you talking about? I just read an email from him. I'm just replying to it, you know, or whatever. I said, no, you must be wrong. And in fact, I'd read the email and I'd sent it to him. And I've since wondered if he ever read my reply. But I'd literally just read it, you know, to see. And he said, check the net. I checked online and sure enough, those stories were starting to appear, you know. And it just doesn't sink in. You know, it's just fake news, as they call it now, you know. But then as time went on, it became a bit apparent it was real. I started to wonder what the hell happened. When I now watch the video of his last video when he was down on the patio on the beach on the 21st of November, just a few days before, he does look frail. He does look very frail. And he also looks quite sad. Unlike Pete, you know, he wasn't his kind of there to the world. He looked quite contemplative, which sinks right in with the email, which I have dated the 24th. It's dated the 24th of November. It's right on the day he died. And it's very unlike Pete, this email. It's so sort of personal, and it's kind of almost like your mother had written it to you, you know. You know, I had to take all this in, and looking back from now, it seems I've got my own theories on what I think happened, but there's been, I've never heard any autopsy reports or anything, you know. But then I watched that video on the patio beach, and that's not the beat I knew. It looks like he's almost accepting something, or something, you know, or maybe just worn down. And the email I've got, which is amongst a million emails from Pete, but it's totally like someone else wrote it. And then suddenly he's dead. You know, it took me, you know, sometimes, lucky I, like I say, I'm not drinking anymore, but when I was, sometimes I'd just break down in tears, you know, thinking about some of the good times we had, you know, particularly out in Thailand. Because, like I say, we worked a lot closer there. There was not a studio in the way. There was not other people in the way. We'd just work. His little maids would make some nice noodles. We'd go down, we'd eat, we'd go back to work, you know. So it's a lot of time spent, you know, close up, as opposed to with a studio in the way, or machinery. So yeah, it was very sad.
What's the one thing you miss most about him?
I miss the magic of where things might go. Everything seems more ordinary. Because he could, like I said, with the Threshold House Choir, you know, you don't expect that from Pete. He's gone off in a totally different place, you know. And I miss that in terms of creating things.
I know. You.
I'm E23. You've been dialed into a special edition of Electronic Air here on KGNU Boulder, Denver, and Fort Collins. This has been a special edition featuring the talents of Danny Hyde, a renowned engineer, recording artist, producer, and composer. In particular, he has been renowned for his longstanding collaborative work with Peter Christopherson and Jeff Rushton, a.k.a. Jhon Balance, from the band Coil. We've heard 2 hours of back-to-back tracks, as well as exclusive interview between myself and Danny Hyde when I was in London this past spring. Going through the set list, a lot of music played in the last hour in support of some of the conversation taking place during that exclusive interview. Tried to throw in as many tracks as possible that really augmented part of the discussion that was going on. Heard music at the top of the hour from Coil versus Elf. That track was called Protection off of the Born Again Pagans EP. Then Coil versus the Eschaton, a dance classic called NASA Arab, one that gives you a little bit of a 5/4 time throw off if you're actually at the decks trying to mix it. So it was kind of fun talking to Danny really about the origins of some of the nuances behind that beat structure. Heard some tracks that were underlying some of the conversation between myself and Danny Hyde, just buried down in the mix. Threw in the intro from Backwards, the most recent and really final release from Coil. It's the album that was recorded between the years 1993 and 1996. Took decades to find an official release, which have now been mastered and put out by Danny, working with the imprint Cold Spring. Backwards came out in 2016. Also, music from that album, Fire of the Green Dragon, is the name of the track that came off of that. And then heard from one of Danny's solo projects called Oral Rage, Unhealthy Red, which is a play on an unearthly red, which is a track that was done in collaboration with Coil. That was sort of a remix effort on that one. From the new Backwards, we heard Coil's Copacabana, and then from Backwards proper, Aeor, It's In My Blood. Rounded out the set with several tracks from Nine Inch Nails, Downward Spiral, The Bottom, two edits of that I worked into underlying some of the interview conversation, and then Coil and Nine Inch Nails with Closer, that's the Unrecalled mix off of the most recent Recoiled EP, also put out by Cold Spring. We finished it off with Desert Shores by XTG. That's the Throbbing Gristle project without Genesis Peorage. That really finished out the Throbbing Gristle lineage. It was dedicated to Peter Sleazy Christopherson after he passed away. Desert Shores was the track that we heard. It features the vocals of many of Peter Christopherson's collaborators over the years, including Danny Hyde. Desert Shore was a cover album conceptualized by Peter Christopherson. All of the work for it was done prior to his death in demo format, and then it was completed by Chris Carter and Cozy Fanny Tutti as a tribute to Peter Christopherson, released as the final release in the Throbbing Gristle catalog. And then we finished off with one of Peter Christopherson's solo projects, the Threshold Houseboys Choir, So Free It Knows No End. I'm E23. Thanks for joining me tonight for this special edition of Electronic Air. It's been a pleasure. And occasionally we get to do something fun like this where we have featured artists, featured genres or themes, as well as exclusive interviews with producers, artists, DJs, etc. So you can always tune in to afterfm.com for archives of any of the programs we play here on KGNU. And we also archive select mixes on mixcloud.com.